Did you know that Jordan Peterson is the founder of his own church, the Church of Saint Joachim of Fiore? A friend of mine, Patrick Coffin, interviewed Dr. Jordan Peterson and asked him, "Why aren't you a Catholic Christian?" And Dr. Peterson answered humorously, saying that he had already founded his own church, the Church of Saint Joachim of Fiore, and then he referred briefly to Joachim of Fiore's theory of an age of a Father and of the Son and an age of the Holy Spirit. And today I want to look at that clip and talk about the theology, the philosophy of Jordan Peterson and why it would be that he's attracted to this obscure medieval abbot, this celebrated theologian who was later called a heretic. Why is it that Dr. Jordan Peterson would be attracted to the paradigm of Joachim of Fiore? Before we do that, let's take a look at the clip in which Patrick Coffin interviews him and asks that question. And I would encourage you to watch the whole interview over at Patrick Coffin's YouTube channel, Patrick Coffin Media.
How would you finish this sentence? "Patrick, right now I'm not Catholic because..."
Oh, well, I can give you a comical answer.
Sure.
I have my own church.
You have your own church?
Set up like 6 years ago, something like that. Yeah.
Should,
and I
is
did
the
that
Church
because,
of Jordan? Should
no,
I,
no,
who,
no, it's
who
not.
I worship?
It's the Church of St. Joachim of Floris, actually.
St. Joachim of Floris. Okay.
Yeah, he was a mystic, a medieval mystic, who just about got burnt at the stake. He had a doctrine of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Ghost. It was a kind of a precursor to psychoanalytic theory, I would say, where he believed there was a Christian epoch of 1,000 years that was the epoch of the Father, and then there was a epoch of the Son, and then there would be an epoch of the Holy Spirit, which was the dawning modern age. And I kind of liked that idea. I thought it was interesting developmental progression. And so I set up this online church. The reason I did it was because a friend of mine, a former student, had asked me to officiate at his wedding. And so I thought, well, I need a church if I'm going to do that. And so I set up this church, and I thought, it's a church. I'm the only member of this church, by the way. And I'm the metropolitan of the church because I thought that would be very amusing. And it only has one rule at the moment, which is don't follow stupid rules, which I thought was a really funny rule. And so, well, that's my comical.
So the altar is a mirror.
That. Yeah, yeah. So you know, I think that's ridiculously comical. But
so Joachim of Fiore is not actually a saint in the Catholic Church. He's actually a blessed, which is the intermediary step of becoming a Catholic saint in the Catholic Church. His feast day, however, is May 29th. Joachim of Fiore was born in the kingdom of Sicily, and he was the son of a notary named Mauro and his wife Gemma. In 1159, Joachim went on pilgrimage to the Holy Land, and he had a spiritual crisis. He underwent some kind of a religious conversion there at Jerusalem, and he decided to put the worldly ways, his secular life, behind him and to pursue a life of monasticism. So upon returning, he joined a Cistercian abbey in Calabria. Now, the Cistercians are a reform movement of the Benedictine order, so they're even stricter than the traditional Benedictine. They wanted to go back to the original austere rule of Saint Benedict of Nursia. And he became a celebrated preacher during this time. In 1168, he joined the monks at the abbey at Carrazzo, and at this time he was ordained a presbyter, a priest. Like most monastic priests of this time, he studied the scriptures, biblical theology, and he found a great interest in the Apocalypse, that is, the Book of Revelation, which is written down by St. John, the beloved apostle of our Lord Jesus Christ. Now, about 9 years later, the monks of his abbey there at Carrazzo voted him as their abbot. In 1182, Joachim of Fiore appealed to the Pope, Lucius III, and he wanted to join his monastery with the Cistercians, but also at this time, he's getting notoriety in Rome, and the Pope recognizes him as a great preacher, but also as a great scholar. And this is where the identity of Joachim of Fiore goes from being an abbot and a monastic reformer into an innovative theologian and biblical scholar, especially on the Book of Revelation. he's encouraged by the Pope to begin writing down his sermons and writing down his biblical commentary. His writings are spread all throughout Europe, and even King Richard Lionheart wanted to meet him and discuss the Book of Revelation while he was passing through on the Third Crusade around the year 1189. The apocalyptic writings of Joachim of Fiore were presented to Pope Innocent III in the year 1200. And unfortunately, Joachim died in 1202 before any judgment was made on his writings, but he died in the bosom of the church, in the faith of the church, as a celebrated theologian and preacher. Now, as time went on and as his theology was analyzed, controversy followed. So let's take a moment and look at the theology of Joachim of Fiore, and we'll see how it fits in to the psychological and philosophical worldview of Dr. Jordan Peterson. Now, Joachim of Fiore, his greatest book, his magnum opus, was his exposition on the apocalypse. This is his biblical commentary on the Book of Revelation. And in this work, he introduces the idea of three ages. Now, Jordan Peterson refers to this in the interview with Patrick Coffin. These three ages, as I mentioned before, and as Jordan Peterson mentioned, are the age of the Father, the age of the Son, and the age of the Holy Spirit. The age of the Father corresponds to the Old Testament. It's characterized by the obedience of humanity to the law of God. It's an epic of justice and of law, symbolized by Moses, the lawgiver. The next age is the age of the Son. And this is the period between the birth of Jesus Christ all the way until the end of the church age, which Joachim of Fiore identifies as ending in the year of our Lord, 1260. And this is the age of Jesus Christ, the second person of the Trinity. It's the age of the seven sacraments. It's the age of the papacy, of the bishops, of the institutional church. The third age is the age of the Holy Spirit, and it is the greatest age in the mind of Joachim of Fiore. According to Joachim of Fiore, mankind during this age, through Jesus Christ, would come into direct contact with God by the power of the Holy Spirit. The kingdom of the Holy Spirit is a new economy, a new dispensation of love, and it proceeds from the gospel of Christ. So it's not a putting away of Jesus Christ, but instead there's now an unmediated relationship between the faithful directly to God in the Holy Spirit. And this new movement would be characterized by charity, poverty, and humility. One of the interesting features of Joachim of Fiore's three ages is the number 1260. Joachim of Fiore prophesies that in the year 1260, the transition will go from the age of the Son to the age of the Holy Spirit. How did he calculate that year? Well, he's getting it, again, from the Book of Revelation. In the Book of Revelation, it reads that the Gentiles will trample on the holy city for 42 months, and I will appoint my two witnesses, and they will prophesy for 1,260 days clothed in sackcloth. Again, we see in Revelation 12:6, the woman fled into the wilderness to a place prepared for her by God, where she might be taken care of for 1,260 days. Here, Joachim of Fiore is seeing the figure of the mother of the Messiah, the Blessed Virgin Mary, as an icon for the church. And so the church goes into the wilderness and is protected by God for 1,260 days. For Joachim of Fiore, these aren't literal days, they are years. So from the time of Christ all the way until 1260, 1,260 days, is the age of Jesus Christ. It is the age of the Catholic Church. But then after that begins the third and final millennial kingdom of the Holy Spirit, where we have direct access to the Father, to the Son, through the Holy Spirit. Now, something interesting happened in Catholic Church history right after Joachim of Fiore died, and that is the founding of the Franciscan and the Dominican orders. St. Francis started the Order of the Friars Minor, the Franciscan Order, in 1209, so just 7 years after the death of Joachim of Fiore. And Francis himself dies in 1226. And so you can see that Francis is right before this number of 1260. Around 1270, Angelo de Clareno founded a Fraticelli sect, sometimes named after him as the Clareni. Now, the Fraticelli, which is Italian for the Little Brothers, are also sometimes called the Spiritual Franciscans. And if you read Umberto Eco's novel, The Name of the Rose, this book is set up with the prosecution of this same sect, the Fraticelli, which are the Spiritual Franciscans. And Angelo de Clareno saw the advent of Saint Francis of Assisi as bringing in the third age of the Holy Spirit, prophesied by Joachim of Fiore. The idea is Saint Francis wasn't a cardinal or a pope or a bishop or a priest. He was just a humble man who communed with God directly. He even received the stigmata of Jesus Christ through the Holy Spirit. And so Francis is seen as sort of a John the Baptist figure. He's heralding in this new third age of the Holy Spirit in a court of Joachim of Fiore. The only problem is the popes in Rome, of course, did not like this idea that they would be superseded by an age of the Holy Spirit, that the hierarchy, the cardinals, the popes, the bishops, all that would go away, and all the faithful would commune directly with God. So they condemned it. By 1296, Pope Boniface VIII, who himself is quite a character, declares this teaching as heretical. The followers of Angelo de Clareno, the Clareni, or Clarinists, begin to fade out because the orders Friar Minor, the official Franciscan order, takes over and conforms itself with the Catholic Church, with the papacy, and with the hierarchy. Nevertheless, the Franciscans and the Augustinians continued to hold the writings of Joachim of Fiore in esteem and as orthodox, and they had a revised or modified interpretation that, yes, indeed, the Church was moving into a new age of the Holy Spirit. It just wasn't as radical as the Clarinists or the Clareni, the Fraticelli, were proposing it to be. It's notable that during the Black Plague, when so many of the clergy died, and I did a video of this on the New St. Thomas Institute, when we looked at the demographics of all the people that died. You can check that out at newstthomas.com. That there weren't many priests in some towns. In some towns, there were no priests. And so this idea that people could still be saved without attending Mass, or if they were dying and there wasn't a priest available for confession or for last rites, that they could still be saved, they could still be justified. This idea kind of goes in favor with Joachim of Fiore, that people can access God through the Holy Spirit without the presence of a priest at their bedside. And of course, when we get to the 1500s, with Martin Luther and John Calvin and Bucer and all of these reformers all over Europe, they are going to love Joachim of Fiore because, again, they are trying to promote a Christianity that is less sacramental, less hierarchical. Before we jump back to Dr. Jordan Peterson, I just want to sum up this idea of a form of Christianity in the third age of the Holy Spirit. First off, it's the idea that you can be saved without a hierarchical visible church. This means that the Pope is not necessary per se, the priest is not necessary per se, the official sacrament is not necessary per se, that God can save the soul without these instituted means. And by the way, Joachim of Fiore would say these means were instituted by Jesus Christ. He's not rejecting them or saying that the Catholic Church made them up. He's accepting them as a priest, as an abbot, as a friend of the Pope. He's accepting these structures as instituted by Jesus Christ. But he's saying that there's a time coming in which intimacy with Jesus will grow even deeper, and that will be mediated by the power of the Holy Spirit. And this has led some people to suggest that Joachim of Fiore was suggesting a kind of Gnosticism. You know, the early Gnostics said that salvation could be found through knowledge, and not through the sacramental life, not through the life of the ecclesiastical communion, through the Eucharist, through union with the bishop, through martyrdom, etc. And I don't think that that's necessarily fair. Joachim of Fiore, again, is not a Gnostic. He is orthodox with regard to the Trinity. He's orthodox with regard to the Church and the sacrament. But he is seeing a change in how salvation is communicated and how people experience God. One last thing, Joachim of Fiore made very popular this idea of three circles linked in on one another with the four letters I, E, V, E. And he's getting this from the Old Testament, from what he would call the age of the Father. And this is his Latin way of producing the tetragrammaton, the name of the Lord, as we know it, Yahweh. It's the I, H, W, H, or in Latin, I, E, V. There is no W in Latin, and E. This is the name of God. It is I am who I am. It refers to the divine essence. As Thomas Aquinas says, qui est, he who is. And notably, it is used by the Borromeo family, of which St. Charles Borromeo derives. It's this idea of the shield of the Trinity, the three interlinked circles. So again, this comes from Joachim of Fiore, and I think it testifies to his orthodoxy and to him actually being a sound Catholic who dies in the bosom of the Church. So that brings us back to Dr. Jordan Peterson. I have really enjoyed watching Dr. Peterson on YouTube, listening to him on the Joe Rogan podcast, seeing his articles, everything he's doing. I've been impressed. And I think what he's doing is returning people back to the sanity and the rationality of nature. And by doing that, he's showing that there's also something behind nature, as we would say, metaphysical. Meta behind fousis nature. That when we root ourselves in reality, in nature, we see an organizing principle. And Jordan Peterson is ready to admit that that organizing principle is the logos. It is the word. It's the logical. It's the rational. It's the speech of God. As we Christians say, the logos is Jesus Christ. It's the word made flesh. And so Dr. Jordan Peterson's down with all of that. What Dr. Peterson seems not to be down with is the idea that there is a formal institution that mediates grace, that mediates the logos to humanity. And a lot of people in our time period have a hard time accepting that, especially when you look around right now and there is corruption in child abuse and abuse of seminarians by cardinals and archbishops and bishops. It's hard to see how this institution of popes and clergy is somehow part of Jesus's plan. And wouldn't it be better if there were a way we could just access God directly? I think Dr. Jordan Peterson, as someone interested in psychology, who's enthusiastic about Jung, sees the mind as being able to grasp rational ideas, even rational entities. And so this idea of Joachim of Fiore, that we as a church or as Christians or even as humanity are progressing to an access of the divine, to access God through the Holy Spirit, the pneuma, a pneumatic reception of the divine, is just in line, I think, with his training and the way that he sees metaphor and metaphysics coming together. I'm a Catholic. I'm a Catholic Christian. And so I can't run off and join the Third Age or join the Church of St. Joachim of Fiore with Dr. Jordan Peterson. But I do get what he appreciates about it. And I do get why thousands, hundreds of thousands of Christians into the 1200s and 1300s and 1400s and 1500s have returned to Joachim of Fiore and found inspiration there. I think we can say, as Catholic Christians, and I'm ready to say this right here on camera, that the Holy Spirit blows where he wills. And you could be in a place of persecution, you could be in a place with corrupt clergy, and the salvation of Jesus Christ, merited for us on the cross, can be applied to us by the Holy Spirit in any way the Holy Spirit so chooses, so long as there's faith and hope and charity present in the recipient. In the Catholic Church, we have the doctrine that there is baptism by desire. There is even spiritual communion, where we believe we can receive the Eucharist spiritually, not even at a Mass. So these ideas are already there. We can't take these ideas, though, and dispense with the physical sacraments. And I just will close with this. The age of the Son is the age of the Logos, the Word, made flesh. And until Jesus returns again, that flesh part, that physicality, the stuff, the matter, the material, is always going to be a part of Christianity. Yes, Jesus Christ was raised by the power of the Holy Spirit. He was incarnate by the Holy Spirit. But remember, the power of the Holy Spirit in the womb of the Virgin Mary gave us a physical Christ, body, blood, soul, and divinity. So my hope is that Dr. Peterson, as he prays and reads and studies, sees that there's not a tension necessarily there, and that Catholicism holds up the best of pneumatic Christianity, of the miraculous workings of the Holy Spirit in all kinds of ways, unmediated, but the Holy Spirit also brings in mediated means, for example, the incarnation of Jesus Christ. Well, hey, thanks for watching. If you like this video, please like and subscribe for more videos to come. Again, my name is Dr. Taylor Marshall, and thanks for watching.